How you doing? Nope, my name's not Rusty. I'm the lawnmower lady, and I like fixing small engines. Today's video is going to be how I diagnose a fuel delivery problem. It's obviously a fuel delivery problem on this little Troy-Bilt TB130. It has a Honda GCV160 engine in it. I suspect it probably got put up last year with bad fuel in it, or perhaps there's water in the fuel right now. I've done everything up to this point and know it's a fuel delivery issue. The spark plug is completely dry, but it will come to life for, you know, a half a second or a second or so when I spray some carb cleaner or something like that directly in the carburetor. So follow along. I'm going to show you what I go through to diagnose and fix this problem. Maybe you might learn a few things along the way. Follow along. All right, these Hondas conveniently have a fuel shutoff valve. They usually have a little diagram there to show you what's what. But basically, when the lever is in line with the fuel, it's open. When it's perpendicular, it's closed. I'll be removing the shroud and top cover to get to the mechanism back there, and then the airbox, the air filter. I'll eventually need to possibly remove the carburetor. Let's get to it. All right, I use a little light-duty impact driver to remove these things. You don't want to use an impact to put them back on, but it certainly gives you up to take them off. And the recoil starter pops off, and then we ought to be able to just lift off the fuel tank just out of the way, so we'll have better access to behind the carburetor. So I've already cleaned the air filter and put in a new spark plug, so I know that's not the problem. And like I said, it does start for and maybe run for a couple of seconds, or maybe a half a second with the if I put some carb spray or something like that in there. And the plug is completely dry, so I know it is definitely a fuel delivery issue. First thing I'm going to do is use that same 10 millimeter to take off, to loosen these bolts. Not going to take them all the way off yet, because there's a whole mess of gaskets back there that will fall off. I'm going to just remove the airbox to get it out of the way. I'll take off one at a time. And try to hold everything in place. Pull that airbox out of the way, and I will attempt to put these screws back in without dropping any of the gaskets. Honda has a whole mess of gaskets here. There's one there, two there, another in the back. So you don't want to lose those if you can help it, because they tend to fall off pretty easily. So Honda does make a tool that's basically these bolts with the heads cut off of them, and you can screw that in to keep them separate. I don't do it. Most people don't have the need to do that. These are just back in hand tight. I'm going to take off the bottom bowl nut right there, drain out what's in the bowl, and then I'll turn the fuel tap back on, and that'll do two things. That'll let me see what's in the carburetor bowl, and then secondly, I will be able to make sure the fuel tap or the fuel lines are clear and free and running. This is a 10 millimeter. Just loosen that up until it comes off. A little bit of fuel dripping out of there, and boy, that burns and stings on the holes in my hand. I might have to go get me a pair of gloves right here. All right, the fuel that's dripping out of there does not look so pretty. I'm going to turn the fuel tap back on and see what's going to flow out of here. And that's really not much at all. I suspect maybe there's a blockage not allowing fuel to get through there. Let's see if we can get this bowl off of here. Alright, doesn't want to come off. Time to get the little hammer. Always use the smallest hammer that you can get away with. Just trying to tap it. There we go. Oh, yeah! There is a mess of gooey stuff inside of here. Let me shut off the fuel valve and show you what is inside of here. I don't know if you can see that or not, but that is a mess that was inside of there. And that right there, oops, is what came out of the carburetor. So, I know where to go from here. All right, so here's another picture of all the jello and mess that came out of there. I don't know if you can see inside that carb, but it's pretty bad as well. A lot of jello there. Had this flown free, as you can see, there's still a lot of jello sort of on the underside of the carb pickup. I have a good friend in England that gave me this teeny tiny little screwdriver that I shaved off the sides of, and you can actually, I use that. Had it been clear, I would have used that to just pull out the main jet and the stack and clean that and put it back together without having to remove the carb. It's convenient, but obviously not this time. I'm going to have to pull this off, and I'm going to run it through the ultrasonic cleaner, and I'll show you how it all comes apart. All right, so I went ahead and pulled the airbox out of the way, and I got to remove this little fuel clamp right here. Supposedly they're one-time use, but people reuse them all the time. Some people use a pick and sort of twist it open and work it off. I'm kind of partial sometimes to just some good old needle-nose pliers to squeeze it open. Then with a different pair of needle nose pliers that have some teeth on them, try to work that fuel line off and get it loose. And be mindful there might be a little bit of fuel leaking out of there, but it won't be a whole lot. All right, be ready to catch it if it does. Then we're going to remove the bolts. Careful now, keep in mind all these gaskets and the order they come off in. There's this gasket and those two bolts right there. The carburetor comes off. And also there's this auto choke mechanism that only goes back on one way. You need to be careful there. I've seen these get broken before. Goes on that way. And if your auto choke never works, by the way, there's a little wax plug right up in there. Kind of hard to see. That sometimes that's an easy fix too if that doesn't work. Not so bad. There's another gasket there, and then this big giant gasket on the backside, which I'm going to attempt to take all these off without tearing them. I do have a few replacements. All right, good job. Just remember how those come off. The next thing I'm going to do is remove the governor return spring out of the little hole in the back. It's kind of fiddly. And then you have to run this guy. It's an L-shaped bracket and pops off like that. Okay, so we'll be taking this apart. You can see all the jello mess on there. It's pretty ugly. So we'll be cleaning that up and running it through the ultrasonic cleaner. I seem to always have a lot of bad gas. No joke there. But I use that to clean off the outside of carburetors. First thing I'm going to do is pull the pin here. And pull the float. Pin comes out, float. Watch out for the float needle right there. Okay, you don't want to lose that. And then you see it's not too bad on the inside, but it's really, really junked up inside of there. So get a little bit of brush action here. This just had a lot of water and a lot of gunk in there. All right, ooh, and there's actually a good fair amount of gunk inside of there. Let me get the outside as much off of there as I can. I don't want that going through the ultrasonic cleaner or filling it up, by the way. The bowl gasket will probably be okay. I probably won't need to take that off of there. The next thing I'm going to do is take out the main jet and the atomizer tube. With that, you need a screwdriver that's got a flat side on there like that. If you try to use one that's got a wedge side, you will actually tear up the threads inside of there. So let's try to get that main jet out. All right. And it sometimes has trouble coming out of there. It often doesn't want to come all the way out. And if it doesn't want to come all the way out, I will help it along with a small pick or something, pushing through the intake hole as I unscrew that. All right, we're almost there. Sometimes I gotta turn that thing upside down to get the screw to come out, because it is hanging up on the threads that hold the bowl screw on. All right, a little more surgery here. And there, it's peeking out right there. Now it should pop right out. I think with so much gunk in there, it's not wanting to come out easily. There we go. All right, so that's probably going to be pretty well jammed up. And the next thing is the atomizer tube in there. And you can look inside. It's the brass tube sticking up in the top, which we're going to sort of press down with a screwdriver on that to get that to pop out. All right. There we go. So this also has a lot of gunk and dirt on there. We'll be putting all this in the ultrasonic cleaner, and it'll come out all nice and pretty and clean. All right, so this is out of the parts cleaner, which is good, and I realize not everyone has the luxury of an ultrasonic cleaner. But what you want to do is lightly spray, you know, just a little bit of carb spray or brake cleaner into every orifice. And what you want to do is, if you spray a little bit in this hole, you want to see it come out some other hole somewhere else. Holes there, even a little hole right inside of there as well. So you want to just, like I said, just make sure whatever you spray in should come out somewhere else. The needle itself is in good shape. You want to make sure that the rubber tip on there is good. The needle seat itself is nice and shiny. You might not be able to see that, but it's good. And then the atomizer and the main jet, they obviously came out real nice and clean. If you don't have this, then I recommend you, any old, you know, wires will do. I use old guitar strings are good. Just make sure they go through those holes all the way straight through, just to double check. And these are obviously all very clean. All right. Same thing on the main jet. Might need to get a little bigger guitar string for that one. You just don't want to use something too big that will enlarge the hole. All right. It's nice and clean. The float is in good shape. Shake it around. There's no fluid in there. And the last thing that I failed to show you when I took it apart is there's a screw on top of these Keihin carburetors that you do want to remove. There's another jet right in there. Comes out somewhere else inside of there. So that's always good to remove. That's on there really, really tight. So we're going to put this back together and tighten that back down. All right. Then I use just a little touch of WD-40, something like that, to lubricate all this stuff. It has gotten all nice and dry coming out of the parts cleaner. A little WD-40 is not going to hurt anything. And it'll help keep you from cross-threading that stuff. All right. The tall end goes in first. That's the one that's going to stick out. And this has a nice little flat end that the main jet is going to screw into. Same thing there. A little bit of WD-40. And get that started. Again, your screwdriver with the flat sides. You don't want one with flared sides. Get that started. You see it drops down past most of those other threads. And then once it gets there, just snug it up. Don't really need to do a whole lot. And then once you look inside, you'll be able to see. Open that up, you can see through there. You'll be able to see that brass nozzle sticking up right in there. Next thing, we're going to assemble the needle. Make sure that, oops, don't throw it across your shop like I just did. Make sure that's clean. And lower the needle gently into the hole. And then the hinge pin is going to go through here and make sure that's pretty centered. And make sure nothing is jamming up. Yep, works good. All right, the carb bowl itself, I do not usually run these Honda ones through the parts cleaner because they're plated, and oftentimes if there's a bit of corrosion and it's starting to come apart, it'll start taking all that plating off of there, but you can still see there's a lump of something still in there. So I'm going to spray just a touch of carb cleaner in there and try to run that out with a rag. Yeah, as you can see, there's a little bit of rust now inside of the bottom of that bowl, but as long as there's no gasoline in there, no water. And I realize water might get in there because of ethanol. I'm going to hit that with a little bit of vinegar and water to neutralize that rust and put this back together. Check to make sure everything's in there together. The bowl gasket's in good shape. I rarely have to replace those. I'll only do that if the bowl starts leaking. And get that screw started in there. There's a gasket on the bottom. Make sure that's clean and not torn up. And this takes a 10 millimeter to tighten that on, and I tighten that on pretty hot, pretty tough. More than a gentle quarter turn. There we go. One more. All right. Hopefully that will not be leaking, and we'll get it back together. All right, so now that we have our carburetor all reassembled and ready to go, we're going to put all this back together. And if you don't remember how the gaskets went on there, you can go back and look at the video or give you a quick rundown right here. I've cleaned all the gasket faces off. This gasket right here never came off. The next thing to go on is the auto choke mechanism. And then there's this gasket right here. And you can see the way this used to go on. I don't know if you can see that reflection right there. That matches up with this little guy right here. Okay, that goes on that way. Then there's the this gasket right here. If you notice, this hole right here has to line up with that hole. Then the airbox, and then the screws go through there. If this choke mechanism is kind of delicate, so you want to be careful there, But this piston there lines up with the little wax plug right there. And I've actually had these break before or come to me broken. I actually had one last year that came from the manufacturer broken like that. He came on upside down all broken. If, incidentally, you break yours, it is Honda part number 16600Z8B900 is the part number. But first thing we have to do is hook up the fuel line and the linkages. We really can't get to that when it's behind the airbox. Push that all the way on. Little fuel. Get that. Don't want to knock that out. The little hose clamp. Actually, sort of slide that almost all the way down. Like I said, some people use picks. I've gotten pretty good at pliers. Sort of put that on. So it's just behind the barb of the fuel line. Next thing is you're going to have to turn the carb like 90 degrees, and we're going to put the governor control arm in the big hole and then the return spring in the small hole. Put that governor arm. You have to bend it towards it just a little bit. Not much. All right. I think I got a little bend in there. I'm going to bend that back out. Oh, no. No, I think that's supposed to be there. And then the small spring goes in the small hole like that. Okay. So we're going to put all this stuff together. Let's remember this is going to go here. Actually, I'm going to start with our airbox. This is where it gets fiddly because that goes under and over. Attach the airbox, the breather tube, back to here. It's hard to do, but all right. So we have the carburetor in our hand. First thing we're going to do is put this guy right here, and we're going to set one screw through the airbox and sort of get that started through there, and then set the other screw to the airbox, and we're going to go through. See, I told you it was fiddly. All right. Both of those. Make sure they go all the way in on the front side. Make sure you're not snagging anything at that point. And here's where it gets really fun. The next thing is this flat gasket right here. It goes on the back side of the carburetor like that. And I'm holding those screws in with my fingers on the front side. Then the auto choke plate goes right up in there. And then, it's where you have to sort of fly blind at this point. Put those guys, get those started on each side. All right, looks like we're mostly all the way home there. Now, one thing I forgot to do, which I will do before I get this tightened all the way down, is I should have checked the fuel flow to make sure my carb bowl is not leaking, because we did not replace the gasket on that. So let me open the fuel tap right now and give it a second. I'll see if I feel any gasoline coming out from the bottom side there. Feels pretty dry to me. So I think we're going to be good there. Turn it back off until we're ready to go. And then we can gently tighten all these guys. a little bit at a time. Don't want to do one all the way tight and then come back and we've broken that auto choke thing. And if you notice too, there's a gap right there. That's eventually going to cinch up as we tighten these down. And I don't know what the torque spec is, but just don't overdo it. You are going into aluminum. Don't want to strip those out. And you can also warp your airbox. Okay. So everything should be good to go there. Feel around. I still don't feel any gas leaking out of there, so that's a good thing. And the way you can tell that this is doing its job is, it might be kind of hard to see, but the throttle plate in there is closed off, and that's what it's supposed to do. When the auto choke heats up, it'll open that plate up. I know you really probably can't see that, but I'm making a shadow, but it's closed right now. The next thing is to reassemble the airbox. Put the air filter in first. Make sure that's all around. There's two tangs that hook like little hinges on the bottom, and that hinges up, and those snap together on the top. Then the tank goes on. It has to work its way through those holes on the top. Then the recoil starter goes on top of there. And if it doesn't want to set down tight, you might have to pull on the string a little bit. Start those nuts on. And again, same 10 millimeter wrench. Tighten these guys up. Again, I don't know what the spec is, just don't overdo it. These, however, are not going through into plastic, so that's a good thing there. Okay. All right. We should be good to go. Let's get it outside and fire it up and make sure it's a happy lawnmower. The moment of truth. On the fuel tap and let's give her a whirl. First pull! So there you have it. That's how I diagnose and fix a suspected gasoline problem or fuel issue on a Honda mower. Yeah, they're kind of fiddly with all the gaskets and bits and parts. But you can avoid this by turning off that fuel tap at the end of the season and let that thing run dry. That'll keep that from happening in the future. All right, so if you learned something or you liked it, please push the like and subscribe button and I can make more of these videos. Remember, I'm the lawnmower lady. As I'm fond of saying, mow happy. Thanks for watching.